Okay, I'm Claudia Taccalite. I am a CNRS researcher in Marseille in the CINAM laboratory. I'm sorry that I cannot be there because another commitment this week, so it's a pity. I work mainly on optical property and in particular nonlinear optics, and in the last period also electron-phonon coupling. So in this talk, I will present you another approach to study the optical response of a solid, that is a real-time spectroscopy. And let me say that in this talk, I will give a general introduction from my point of view to some of the applications, some of the things that you can do, just to give you an overview. I will start with nonlinear optics, because of the topic on which I worked on for different years. Maybe the part were already explained by Valerie, but okay, repeat sometime, it can be good. Okay, so let me go on. So the first experiment that went beyond linear response appeared in 1961 after the invention of laser, because before laser, everything that was known in optics was only linear optics. After the discovery of laser, Franken was able to show a very nice phenomenon, the fact that on particular crystals, if you send a laser very strong, for example in red here, you get light of different color. And this was the beginning of a very large field of physics, the field of nonlinear optics and then real-time spectroscopy, when the laser became shorter and shorter. The three guys that developed the field are these people here, Blomberg, Shaolo, and Siegmann, that got a Nobel Prize. And also, you can find a nice lecture on YouTube from this guy. Now, let's see what's happened. But nonlinear optics is a phenomenon that probably can be not easy to visualize because it's not something that we have every day in our life. But there is at least one simple example that you can buy in a supermarket, or you could buy in a supermarket. I mean, maybe you already saw, but is this one. Okay, Max. Is the green laser. This is the simplest application of nonlinear optics of a nonlinear response that you can find easily. Now, if you have an old green laser, you may imagine that the laser are all similar, the red, the green, the blue, and so on. But in reality, it's not easy to create a laser. So at the beginning, when people were able to create a red laser, that was the first to be created, they tried to change the color of the laser to get the other colors. And in order to do so, what they did is to use a nonlinear crystal, this object that you can see here. And this crystal, in practice, take the red light, that is this one here, that you see from this red laser here, and change the color to green. And this is the way in which the green laser pointer was created. Now, I have to say that time passed, so the green laser pointer that you can buy in the supermarket are not anymore made in this way, because in 2012, a green laser was created, and so you don't need anymore a nonlinear crystal. But this was just to give you an idea of a simple commercial application on nonlinear optics. Nonlinear optics or a nonlinear property of solids can also not only change the frequency of the laser and mix them, but also they can probe, for example, excitation that are not visible in linear optics. To give you an example, this paper now is quite old, but is at the beginning of this application, was the excitonic spectra of a nanotube. Now, in a nanotube, you have this excitation 1s that is visible, this one here. But then you have one axion that is not visible, this one here, 2p. But if you use a strong laser and you absorb two photons instead of one, you can excite this excitation here. And this spectra that you see here is an example of a spectra of a second or two photon absorption. So the absorption of two photons instead of one. Seems similar to a spectra of linear optics, but it's completely nonlinear. You are very, you're visualizing something that was not possible to see with linear response. And these are the topic or the things that I am interested in. And to study this kind of phenomena, we decided to develop an approach that was a bit different from the way in which you calculate linear response as you have seen in this school. And the idea is to use real-time spectroscopy. So in real-time spectroscopy, what you do, you really have an approach that is much similar to the experiment, because you perturb your system, you really put a perturbation. It's not a field that you will send at zero, it's really a field with a given intensity. The whole system will be excited, and then you record the response as it was done in an experiment, and then you have to analyze the response. So the typical way which you do something like this is to send a laser, put a laser in your simulation that can be a molecule or a solid. In this case, I show you two examples that are commonly used, the delta function that excite all the frequency, so you can use to study linear response, and a sinusoidal electric field that in this case excite only a single frequency if you want to probe a nonlinear phenomena with that frequency. Then you solve some real-time equation that now I say time effective Schrödinger equation. You will see in this talk what you will have to solve. Anyway, you solve a differential equation starting from the ground state. From this time evolution, you get the wave function. From the wave function, you get the polarization. And by Fourier transform, you get your optical spectra. So the approach is really summarized in this slide. Now, to give you an example of how it works, let's go back to the Maxwell equation. In general, when you put a solid maybe it's part of this equation you already saw in this school, but I think it's not bad if I repeat some of them. So when you put a solid in an electric field, the dipoles inside the solid orientate according to the field and create another field that is the polarization. Now, the electric field, the electric displacement, the polarization, they are all related by these so-called master equations, mass material equations. And if you want to know what these fields are, you just go back to the Gauss law here, and you see that the electric field is generated by the total charge, why this electric displacement is generated by the external charge. And so the polarization is the field that connect the two. Now, in general, the polarization of the material is like the response of your material to the external perturbation. In general, what you say that the polarization can be expanded in a power series where there is the first order, the second order, and so on. And you have seen different talks on the linear response part and the part of Valéry on the second harmonic generation and third. And now I will show you how we calculate this response from real time. What you do in real time is to put a perturbation, make them evolve in time, for example, to get a linear response. Suppose that the perturbation is quite small, for example, if you want a linear response, and then you imagine that you can stop this expansion up to here, up to the first order. In this case, you can Fourier transform this quantity and relate directly the polarization to the electric field and find the epsilon in this way. And the epsilon will be the ratio between the electric displacement and the electric field. Now, if you come back to the materials equation, the epsilon will be expressed in this way. So, and if I compare with the formalism in frequency space, this is the expression from the epsilon. So what we do in a real-time simulation? So what you really do is to put an electric field, yeah? Put an electric field make it evolve in time, Fourier transform it to get E d omega, this object here, calculate the polarization, do the Fourier transform, and from the ratio, you get the dielectric constant. And this is the approach of real time. So, but if I limited to the linear response, maybe you can say, okay, this is not so useful. We have many other way to calculate the linear response. Now I want to show you some advantages, if you want, or some why there is some reason to use a real-time approach for this for study linear and non-linear response. And there are also disadvantages. I will show you. So a big advantage of the linear response is, in principle, is the better scaling for large system, in the sense that the polarization depends only from valence band, and you don't need conduction band, but you need to evolve in time. So for very large system, use a real-time approach can be convenient. For example, this figure here that I show you, that the response of a big cluster, metallic cluster, is taken from the presentation of a colleague of mine, Hans Christian Weisker, that use a real-time TDFT to get a linear response on a very big system, because according to him, and I believe his result, for large system, the real-time approach can be promising, very promising. But you have to remember that there is a very big prefactor, and code can be very different. So can be very good with some approximation. Then if you want exchange, can be very expensive. So there are situations that can be very advantageous, like this one of a metallic cluster. And in my opinion, another advantage of real-time formulation is that the code is in some sense easier. So you have to propagate a differential equation, and that's all. And then you have to analyze the response. You are not very complicated equation to code. Another advantage of linear of a real-time approach that you have access to all the polarization, and so you have access to chi1, chi2, and so on, chi3. And the chi are very complicated, because if I consider, for example, the second harmonic, the second order, that is the response to a two laser, you can have two laser that are identical, that is a second harmonic generation. Then you have two laser with different frequency, so they sum, like here. They have two laser that they can subtract because they are out of phase. So you have a lot of physical phenomena that are difficult to describe or require a particular equation for each response function. And the situation became even worse if you increase the nonlinearity of your system. If you have to absorb three photons like this, there is a particular phenomenon, but then you can combine laser in a really a lot of way, like experimentalists do. So it's very difficult to extract all the possible chi3. Or at least you need an equation for each chi3. That is quite impossible. And even more, there are phenomena that are not perturbative, like high harmonic generation, or phenomena that are in time, so they depend not only from the frequency, but from the delay between two lasers, like pump and probe. Or there are also phenomena that are related to the coupling with the atoms and so on. So this is another kind of phenomena that you want to address in real time. Now, so I gave you a brief overview of why one can be interested in real-time simulation and what are the things we can study. But now we have to see some equations. So how you want to do this? And there are a lot of possibilities. First of all, we have to choose which quantity you want to propagate in time. For example, you can use the density, like in TDFT, or the density matrix that is an object of R prime, or the Green function that is G, R, R, T, T, that is, much complicated, or the wave function. So there are a lot, there are different choices, and clearly, more the object you propagate is complex, for example, from the you go in the direction of the wave function, more it is in some sense easy to write the correlation part, but it's much complicated to treat the object. For sure, the Schrodinger equation, we know how to write it, but then we don't know how to propagate or how to solve it. The density has the big advantage that it's a very simple object, but to find the functional, as also Francesco point out, the difficult to find the functional that reproduce exciton. In real time, you have the same problem. You are not able to find the functional that reproduce exciton very well, for example. So it's a complexity that you pay. Or you choose a simple object, like the density, and you pay because you have a complex way to write the correlation, or you choose an object that is much complicated to solve your equation. But in this case, the advantage that in this case to write correlation is much easier. I will give you some examples starting from TDFT. So if you want to solve TDFT in real time, what you have to do is really to solve this equation here. Is a time-dependent version of the Cohn-Sham equation. So you propagate in time these orbitals. You just need the valence band, because then you have to sum only on the valence band to reconstruct the density, that then enter in the Cohn-Sham and in the Hartree potential. Now, TDFT is an exact theory, at least for isolated system. We can discuss for periodic system, there are some problems, but okay, one can use it. And also for real-time simulation, usually the typical approximation that is done in the major part of code is the adiabatic approximation. So it means that the functional of the density should depend also on time, so on the history of your simulation, but to image it is static. So it means that we take you take LDA, CGA, and we just update the density in this function. Now, if you solve this equation in time, you will get a linear and nonlinear response function exactly as the one that you get from TDFT solved from in a way similar to beta sulpide, like Cassidy equation and so on. But now I want to show you also how to relate the other response function. For example, independent particle, RPA. What this means, independent particle or RPA in real time? Just to give you an idea how these two words are connected. But for example, if in the previous equation, you don't update the density in the R3 and in the exchange correlation function, but you keep the density fixed to the ground state one. So it means that you change the wave function. So you have always this wave equation to solve each time. Then you update you keep the density fixed to R0, R equal to R0. And you don't update the density, but just you evolve the wave function in time. What you get is the independent particle response. So it means you allow an electron to jump from valence to conduction bands, but your system will not feel this jump. I mean, the density will not change. It will not have a response. You just get independent particle. If you allow to your system to update the density in the R3 term. So like you can see here in this figure, this is the density that change after an excitation. In this case, you have the TDR3 that correspond to RPA or the local field effect. So in real time formulation, the local field effect are the oscillation of the R3 potential. Finally, if you update the density in the R3 and in the exchange, you have the full TDFT. So your response function will be exactly from real time or from linear response theory, the same of the TDFT. Okay, this was just to give you an idea of how TDFT works in real time. And now I will show you some nice picture. This is a typical simulation that I took from YouTube of a porphyrin in real time. So you see the frequency of the laser that is centered here to this resonance. This is the laser field. And these are the oscillation of the density. Now, notice one important point. if you look at the figure up to right, the laser now is off, is finished the pulse of the laser, but the density continues to oscillate. And why? Because in the standard TDFT, you don't have memory, you don't have the phasing or lifetime. So if you excite the system will continue to oscillate forever. If you want to get a spectra like the one that is shown on the left, you have to introduce a lifetime of dephasing or in post-processing or your own dynamics by hand. And this corresponds exactly to what you do in linear response when you put a small imaginary part in your denominator to get the broadening of the peaks. It's exactly the same. In real time, the broadening on the peaks means that the oscillation will finish after some time. Okay, until now I'll show you the example of TDFT as an example, as a technique to do real-time simulation. But I want to mention that there is also another approach that is our green function, because here you, in the school, you saw a lot of green functions. So the green function can be used also in real time. I'm not going to introduce any real-time formulation of the green function, just to mention that one can write down an equation also for the green function in real time. But you have to remember that the green function was depending from the difference of two time, T1, T prime, because it was the invariance respect to a time shift. But if you use it in real time, this invariance is broken. So you have to really have a green function that depends from T and from T prime separately. And so you get a set of complicated questions to solve that in general can be simplified if you imagine that you want to just solve this question for the diagonal part of the green function. That means for the density matrix. This is the density matrix. And the major part of people that use the green function use this approximation. So they solve an equation for the density matrix where this object here contains all information about the self-energy. Note that all the things that you have seen for the self-energy approximation and so on in linear response, they are the same in real time. I mean, if you use GW self-energy, you can use a GW self-energy real time. If you use RT4, you can use RT4. So there is a correspondence between the two. Typical application of the green function are, for example, electronic relaxation. I put an example here. This is a silicon system where you excite your system, electrons go up, they scatter with phonons, you can see here phonons, so they relax to the minimum of the conduction band, they go down, and this can be probed by the experiment measuring the change in the reflectivity with time, so this measurement here, and this is the calculation, they're not perfect, but okay, at least one gets the physics of this relaxation of the electron. Now, so I show you two ways to do real-time simulation that are TDFT and green function. But I would like to point out the last important point that I didn't specify, that is the external field, how you choose the coupling with the external field and the Hamiltonian. And this is it's a problem both for green function and for TDFT. And I want, since it's a school, I would like to spend some time on the gauge problem. Now, in the previous slide, I show you the TDFT Hamiltonian and the green function without specifying the external field. But in reality, there is some freedom to choose the external field. For example, here I show you two possible gauge. This the length gauge, where the electric field enter in this way, R dot E, or the velocity gauge, where the electric field enter as P minus A. There are infinite gauge, yeah, because the gauge transformation is continuous, so you can choose, you can create your own gauge as you want. But these are the most common one. Now, the point is that quantum mechanics is gauge invariant. So both gauge must give the same result. But in real calculation, the gauge choice as each gauge source has its advantage and disadvantage. I want to show you this important point. In general, one can pass from one gauge to another with the transformation that is this one, the gauge transformation, that is made of three steps. You change, you can modify the vector potential, you can modify the scalar potential, and you change the phase of the wave function, where this is an arbitrary scalar function. So there is a transformation that brings us from one Hamiltonian to another. And in principle, the result should be the same. But there is a problem. The problem is that we are physicists, so we do approximation. And usually we introduce in the Hamiltonian some particular object that are very nasty, that are the non-local operator. And the problem is that these non-local operators, they don't commute with the gauge transformation. And the local non-local operator can be different, can be the pseudo potential, the exchange, the Schiessel operator, and so on. So all these operators, they don't commute with the gauge. So it means that the two Hamiltonian that were equivalent before are not equivalent anymore. For example, if I consider an Hamiltonian in length on velocity gauge with a pseudo potential, the two give different results. And the only way to get correct result is that I introduce, when I pass from one to another, I have introduced this gauge transformation that don't cancel here, and give me a dependence from the external field of the non-local operator. So that's to give you an idea why is one gauge can be more convenient than another. The point is that the non-local operator should be included in the length gauge and then transform into the velocity. So this brings us to the final point on the gauge that I want to discuss, that in the two gauges that are used in the literature, they have different advantages and disadvantages. In the length one, non-local operator can be easily introduced because they don't require any transformation. This is the gauge where you should introduce the non-local operators. But the gauge has a price to pay because in the length gauge, that is the dipole operator R, that is ill-defined in solid. So you need more complicated formulation in terms of Berry phase. If you use this Hamiltonian to do real time, the velocity gauge instead, non-local operator acquire a dependence on the external field. If you look at code that implement the TDFT in real time, you will see that the pseudo potential part depends on the excitation. That is wire, but it's like this, if you want the correct result. On the other hand, the momentum operator P is well defined also for solid. That's the reason the major part of code prefer to work in velocity gauge to have something that works easily for solids with the price to pay that they cannot introduce non-local operator. So this is or at least that is difficult to introduce non-local operator, like the exchange or the Schiessel operator and so on. So this is the price to pay to use the velocity gauge. Okay, now I show you the two ways to do the calculation, TDFT and Green function. The gauge, the possible gauge that you can choose for both TDFT and Green function. Ah, the problem of gauge is present also in Green function, doesn't change. And let me point out also that in the different paper were published with Vrong with the story of gauge and local operators, but okay, I will not cite them. Now I want to give you an overview of just to have an idea of code and people that developed this real-time world and some particular feature that I like of the different code. Oh, here I try to do a summary of the, just to give you an idea of people that are working on real-time spectroscopy. These are a list of code. Probably I forgot someone, but I hope that to be quite exhaustive. And the code that work in real-time spectroscopy can in general be divided in two main families. The one that use TDFT word, the one I showed you before, and the one that use density matrix and Green function. Among this code, there are some very nice features that I would like to underline that to give you an idea that this world has a lot of flexibility to study also physical different physical phenomena. And also that some of this code was really created and developed with the idea to simulate a particular phenomenon. So there are differences. If you can be interested in one of these, we can have a look. In particular, one thing that I like a lot in the TDF code is the possibility to use boundary conditions that are absorbing. It means that you, when you excite your system, you can imagine that your molecule is here in the center. You send your laser, one electron go out, and then it's absorbed. So it means that you don't conserve the number of electrons anymore, but you have access to photoemission. Some people will say that, okay, this is not a correct theory, but okay, people like it. So there are a lot of simulation of photoemission, angle resolved photoemission with TDFT. Then another interesting development is to include quantum dissipation, so the fluctuation and all these things that are in the memory of the kernel. And a code that was particularly developed for this is a QDD, that is quantum dissipative dynamics, developed in Toulouse to take in account the fact that there is a lifetime of the electrons, so that they relax. They have developed their own technique to do so. Other things that people start to do in real time is to couple electrons and ions. So you can excite a system, and then you can see how ions moves after the excitation. And different codes try to also follow this strategy. Salmon, Fiesta, Octopus. And notice that the people in real time like the sea and the fish and so on. And another thing that that was developed in recent years by Salmon is a multi-scale approach coupling Maxwell equation and TDFT to simulate really an incident incident laser beam on a surface and the reflection and transmittance. That is a very nice idea that allow to reproduce a phenomenon that is usually used in electromagnetism, but you cannot simulate so easily. And this same approach allow them to study surface plasmon or near field spectroscopy other technique. Then I will briefly also show what I have done. My work was to, in the recent year, was to develop an approach in the length gauge that I showed you before. And the advantage of the length gauge that it allowed me to introduce non-local operator like the screen exchange, the Schiessel operator, and so on. And so to have an approach that is equivalent to beta Salpeter-like, but in real time. So that was what we have done in recent year with some collaborators. Here is an example of second harmonic generation in hexagonal BN. And these peaks here correspond to the first and second exciton that is visible at the frequency. This is the directing constant of the normal linear optics and half of the frequency because it's a second order process. Finally, I want to mention also the code that use a poor Green function. There are two that use a simplified version, Yambo and Schirz. They use density matrix to do real-time simulation. So it's an approximated version of the real-time Green function. And then there are code that use the full two-time Green function that is that require a very complicated integration in time, that is this object here. So you have to do, when you integrate your differential equation, you have to integrate two times in the same moment. So you get an object that is very expensive to integrate. As far as I know, there are only a couple of code that try to do this, that are Nessi and Schirz. Nessi is a more code for thought for strongly correlated system because it uses self-energy, that is the MFT. And Schirz is a code for, let's say, less correlated, but okay, that use GW on second Born approximation, that is this crossed the diagram here, and is mainly developed for molecular system, for excitation in molecular system. Okay, let me also mention the last point on this code that real-time simulation are used not only for light, but there is also a lot of work to study how other particles interact with material, for example, for radiation damage or for radiation stopping power. So you can really, you can also put in real time not only your photons, but also your electron, your proton. You can send a real time simulation, also other objects that are solved usually in TDFT. And for this, there are other coders, Siesta, MolGW, that use this approach to study other response functions that can be, for example, compared with yields. And okay, I think I give you an overview of the different code and approach that are developed in real time. So here you have the list of all the code. Someone is available, someone is not available. You have to contact the authors, but just to give you an idea that they exist and some people are working on them. I put a list of books that, if you are interested in the topics, I try to order the books from the easiest to the most difficult, even if, okay, this order is a bit arbitrary. For nonlinear optics, this is the best reference you can find. There are all nonlinear phenomena, second, third harmonic generation, two photon, and so on. This is a very simple book on that is mainly based on two bands models that where you get a lot of physics with very simple models. And then for the TDFT, this standard book, and then for the non-equilibrium green function, these two at the end here. Okay, so I was that's the story, a bit of the real-time simulation in the scientific community. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, questions? Just checking also the... That's okay. Hey, Claudio, probably you already mentioned that, but I was away for a moment. Have you talked about the scaling of these approaches with respect to the perturbative approaches?
Yeah, the scaling is a different question. It's complicated because... Let me.
Yeah, that's why it's not obvious. That's why.
Let me explain. I always show this slide that I took from Hans Christian Weisker, that use real time because you say, okay, real time scale better with the system size, and so you can simulate larger metallic cluster. That's probably true, but at least is quite true because it's true that in principle it depends only from valence bands, but there are a lot of work in the implementation. For example, if you image implementation that uses IDOC solver like or LANXOS solver for TDFT in linear response, they are very, very fast. So it's difficult to do better. If you have to diagonalize a big matrix, in this case, the scale can be bad. But the comparison is difficult in this way, in this case. Moreover, there is another factor that one has to take in account, in my opinion, that is the level of correlation you want. In the sense, for a simple function like LDA, EGA, maybe you can write a code that is very efficient in real time because it requires only the density. And so at the end, you scale better. Maybe you can win this this competition. But if you have something that contains the exchange in the spirit of beta salpeter or even simplified exchange, the real time is terrible. It's really, really expensive. So yeah, maybe the scale is better, but you have to go a size that is infinite. I don't know. When you have something that is more complicated, a simple functional, no, there is no way.
Go ahead.
So I was wondering about the gauge part. Why it is, I mean, if it, is it obvious that one can just do things in can do things stably, let's say in the write down the correct Hamiltonian, let's say in the length gauge, because somehow when somebody writes down the Coulomb operator, is kind of in the Coulomb gauge, that's kind of the P dot A gauge.
Yeah, there's a question that I asked to myself for different time. Now that for me the solution is well explained in this paper by Lamb, where in 1987, where Lamb said, okay, the real Hamiltonian that we, when you want to compare, the Lamb has an argument that was very nice. They say that the length gauge, in some sense, is an Hamiltonian where eigenvalues has a physical meaning. And he claimed that in the velocity gauge, that's not so true, because you can always add the constant A to the Hamiltonian. And so this, he said that okay, he gave this was his argument to say that the true Hamiltonian where the eigenvalues are true are the length, and then you have to use everything's there. And then if you compare with linear response, you will realize that if you introduce the non-local potential in the other Hamiltonian, you don't get the same response function. For example, imagine that you introduce the exchange, you want to do R3-Fock, and then you introduce in the wrong Hamiltonian, but you get a different response function. You don't get the one that you study normally in the linear response. You can do the math and then you see that you don't get it.
Yeah, I was wondering because in quantum optics, one has all these supervariant phase transitions that if one starts in the P dot A gauge, one doesn't have because as the A squared term. Well, if one just starts with the P square with the R dot E, it's very tricky to take into account the polarization term that is kind of P squared and as then explicitly in the Hamiltonian.
Yeah, and then if you want, for example, okay, I will mention also this one. Another paper that is very nice is this one from Tokman that show another example that when you write response function in velocity gauge, you always get this divergence at small omega. And for example, Tokman showed that this divergence is, or this wrong response function in velocity gauge are fictitious, are due to the fact that one introduce object in the wrong Hamiltonian. If you introduce all games in the length and then you transform it, you cancel all divergences. I cited this too, but there are a lot of papers that show that the right way to do is in that way.
Okay, other comments, questions? Do you have anything from the audience? No. And I have another point about the codes. In terms of the, because you mentioned sort of together codes, like here I see that they work in time-dependent density functional theory, but also in the Green's function formalism. For what concerns the Green's function, what is the status of the approximation that we use for the self-energy let's say non-equilibriums, for example, for all these non-equilibrium spectroscopy. So do we have GW as sort of the best approximation possible, or what is the status?
Okay, GW is possible to use Let's start in this way. If you have a static self-energy, the life is very easy. If you have a screen, easy. So if you have a screen art refoc, you get everything's easy. If you have a self-energy, it is dynamic, like GW or others, then to evolve in time is very complicated. You have to do approximation. Or you use this two-time integration that is very complicated. You can use that only for simple models. Or you have to do some ansatz and some approximation on the dynamical part. That is what was done. I mentioned this code, but for example, also now in the Berkeley GW, they have done this in the what they call real-time GW, and also CHIRS, they call real-time GW. So there are different recipes to treat the dynamical part of the self-energy that is problematic. And at the end, is a memory. It's like a memory function that you have in TDFT. But it's a memory much more complicated because the wave function, the Green function already depends from time at the equilibrium, while the functional or TDFT doesn't. So we have a double dependence on time. The time that is physical means the time of the experiment, and the time that is internal time, that is a time that describes the lifetime, all the phenomena that are in the Green function. So that's make the life very complicated. You have these two times. In fact, usually I don't like the Green function written this way. I prefer to write them in a way that is tau. You can write like tau and t, where t is the time of the experiment and tau is the internal time of the Green function. Because if you write t tai prime, it's quite confused. Mm-hmm. So there are these two dependencies, and there are a lot of different approximations to treat this problem. So dynamic self energy is still a problem.
Still a problem. Okay. And I guess there is no a simple way to disentangle the two timing here.
I think the only nice solution was the one that was found at the beginning by the Kadanoff and Bayman. So to work only with the one time, only with the diagonal, and then for the part that contains the internal time, so the time of the lifetime and so on, you in some sense approximate with the one at equilibrium. So it's like if you follow the dynamics of the experiment, but then you say the relaxation is similar to the one of the equilibrium. So we approximate in some way this way.
Okay, and is this what it is implemented in YAMBO?
This one is implemented in YAMBO, in CHIRS, as far as I know, also in Berkeley GW.
Okay.
And also you can also have a look at this code that I didn't know where the Nessie also is implemented something like this.
Yeah, never heard of it, in fact. Okay. Okay. Don't see other questions. Oh no, there is one, Eric, yeah.
If you want to show how the density of the electron evolve when in a solid, when we impose a pulse laser, do we have to use the air formalism or the P formalism?
No. For the density is exactly the same. You can use the both formalism and then plot the density easily. I mean, is it just the coupling with the external field, but then the evolution of the density, if you treat well the coupling and so on, they will be exactly the same.
Okay, so, well, thank you very much, Claudio.
Okay.